What's the law on what you can and cannot say on a billboard? I assume you can't say nothing defamatory and you can't say fuck, piss, or cunt. That right?
Or anus?
I think I'll be all right then.
I guess you're Angela Hayes' mother.
That's right. I'm Angela Hayes' mother.
So, Mildred Hayes, why did you put up these billboards?
My daughter Angela was murdered 7 months ago. It seems to me the police department is too busy torturing black folks to solve actual crime.
What the hell is this?
Dixon, I'm in the middle of my goddamn Easter dinner. Sorry, kids.
I know, Chief, but I think we got kind of a problem. Sunshine
beating on a good time. I'd do anything to catch your daughter's killer.
I don't think those billboards is very fair.
The time it took you to get out here whining like a bitch, Willoughby. Some other poor girl's probably out there being butchered right now.
We've had two official complaints about those billboards.
From who?
A lady with a funny eye.
A lady with a funny fucking eye?
And a fat dentist.
There's a lot of good friends of Willoughby in this town, Miss Hayes. Ow! Ah! You didn't happen to drill a little hole in the dentist today, did you?
Of course not.
Huh?
I said, of course not.
I'm sorry about Angela, but the town is dead set against these billboards.
You know who threw that can?
What can?
How about you, sweetheart?
No, I didn't really...
Go, girl.
Hey, fuckhead!
What?
Don't say what, Dixon, when she comes in calling you a fuckhead.
The more you keep a case in the public eye, the better your chances are getting it solved. And when I
see the sun. You know, if you hadn't stopped coming to church, you'd have a little bit more understanding of people's feelings.
All this anger, man. It just begets greater anger.
In 3, 2, 1.
And as sad as the spectacle of these billboards might be, this reporter, for one, hopes this finally puts an end to the strange saga of the three billboards outside.
This doesn't put an end to shit, you fucking retard. This is just a fucking start. Why don't you put that on your Good Morning Missouri fucking wake up broadcast, bitch?
Billboard, which was selected by Margie. And Margie selected three billboards.
We're doing three billboards.
Okay.
And that's what we should do.
I selected three billboards because there's no deep reason behind it. My original choice was King in the Wilderness, was it?
Right.
King in the Wilderness. That was my original choice.
But it hasn't come out.
But it hasn't come out yet. Exactly. I don't think it's up until April, something like that. So then I had to scramble to find a good movie, and I wasn't really sure what was good in the movies, and it was kind of hard because I didn't want to just suggest anything. So it took a while, as you probably know, for me to come up with something. I had a couple of choices. My son was helping me choose. His kids know more about what's going on. He's not a kid, but anyway, he suggested Three Billboards. He suggested Dunkirk. And he suggested a lot of others, but those were like the top two for me. And he assured me that they probably would be, you know, kind of nominated for Best Movie of the Year and all that.
It was
that good. And so I figured the females, I wasn't sure if you could sit through Dunkirk.
Thank you.
But it's Christopher Nolan. But, you know, in the movie theater, you know, it's not like you're at home, you can put it on pause. So, that was it. I chose, and I was a little afraid of Three Billboards because when someone described it to you, it's like a mother who lost her child, and how many movies like that have we seen? Like 10 zillion. So I was a little concerned, but I ran and saw it, as I told you. That was my choice, and I was really glad.
And what rating would you give
it? I would give it an A.
Great. And we'll go... Nelly.
A.
Carol.
A.
Mona.
A.
June.
B plus.
No, A minus. A minus. Okay. Stephanie.
I want to break the... But A.
A.
Jean. Just spit it out.
It doesn't want to say it.
No, yeah. Was it?
No.
B plus. My mom didn't see it.
Okay.
I give it an A minus.
Yeah, I'm going to retract my A.
Okay.
A minus.
Okay.
Good, thanks.
B plus.
But I loved it.
Oh, Denise.
Didn't see it.
Okay.
B minus.
B plus.
Tony, B plus. Val, did you see it?
Yes, B plus. We don't give it like a why.
Ed?
Yeah, we will.
B plus.
Who's next to
Ed? Clarice.
B plus.
Ron.
I give it an A.
Clavita.
B plus.
Daph, didn't see it. Okay. You're up.
An A.
Hope gives it an A as well. And who didn't I get?
A.
Yeah. David.
B plus.
And Gwen gave it a B.
Gwen sure. gave it a B. And Anita gave it. Okay, Anita.
Oh.
B plus.
Gladys gave it an A.
Anita, B plus. And Gladys. Even an A. Oh, I don't know. Oh, I'm sorry, Janice. It's sitting right in front of me, honey. I'm
okay.
Sorry.
It's, I give it an A minus.
Okay. Well, I'd say it was fairly well received.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you had seen it.
Oh,
you
had it.
Yeah. Yeah. See, Puma said if she had seen it, she would have given it an A.
No, we would have given it an A. Other than an A.
Explanations.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the lowest grade. Since we had a lot of A's,
mm-hmm.
The lowest grade was actually Gay, who gave it a B minus. So we'll start with you, Gay.
Well, I'm actually surprised at the reception room for this film.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you what I liked about it, then I'll tell you what I didn't like about it.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly liked the strong female character.
Mm-hmm.
I like Frances McDormand. I've seen a lot of her films, and I think she's terrific. And I liked the storyline of a woman who just wouldn't give up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Why did I not like it? I thought the screenplay did not hold together well. And although, there are a lot of slow movies that I like, this one failed to keep my attention. And I felt that, in the end, I want to feel some sum up.
Some closure.
Something,
yes. Yeah.
And it wasn't there.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure, when the movie was over, I sort of felt like, well, why did I make this,
mm-hmm.
What, there's no, story line. And it's not just simply that, a woman didn't give up and didn't, win her objective. That's okay, but it just wasn't. It wasn't there. I think that this is a movie that if Frances McDormand had not been in it, it would never have gotten the attention that it got. She is, Woody Harrelson is a phenomenal actor. And actually, I might have thought that he did a better job than she did. But anyway, that's it.
All right, well, we've got a lot of A's and B pluses, so... let me give to Margie because she picked the film.
Well, I didn't know what the movie was about other than, that generalization. The mother who lost her child and she was going to go after whomever to find out who killed her child. So I didn't know when it was recommended. I didn't know who was in it. That's all I knew. So if she were not in it, you said it probably wouldn't have gotten the attention. That's not true, because I didn't suggest it based on anything other than a recommendation from my son who suggested.
Yeah, I didn't mean you.
No, I know, but that's what led me to make the choice. And I didn't really know anything about it, and I don't choose, you know, I didn't know who she was. Even if he had said so-and-so was in it, I still wouldn't have known who she was until I saw her. So, I'm glad that I went in not knowing anything about the movie and was doing it solely based on it being highly recommended by someone else who I know wasn't choosing it for the someone being like this Frances. What's her name? Frances. I still don't know her name. I know who she is because I've seen her over the years. But as I said, when I saw the movie, and I was compelled after like the first 5 minutes. The first 5 minutes the movie had. And to me, that was huge. That was huge. So I knew that the movie was going to be
huge. I like that word now.
That's how you said it. That's funny. But again, within the first 5 minutes of the movie, I knew that the movie was going to be great, and it was.
Yeah, I liked it because I didn't know anything about it except it has three billboards. And I like the fact that it unfolded in really unexpected ways.
Right.
And I liked it. And at the point where I gave it a B plus is that toward the end it started to drag for me and they ended it.
Yeah.
And I liked the ending.
I did too. I did too.
They were discovering limits of their morality, their compassion, and I think the turnabout for her came when she picked up the wine bottle and you knew she was going to assault her husband, and she did not.
Yeah.
And that, to me, was a transformative moment for her.
Mm-hmm.
And to see what Sam Rockwell, the compassion that Red showed by offering him some ginger ale or
the
water
juice,
after being thrown out the window by him. I don't know, I would probably hit the guy in the head with a bit. You know, so I really appreciated that, but it did start to lag, and they ended it just in time.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So
that is definitely.
You know, it's true. It wasn't a good story in terms of beginning, middle, and end, and what appeared to be about a mother.
Right.
It had nothing to do with the billboards or her losing her child. What intrigued me was it was a real character study.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I got to enter into not only the heads, but the psychological evolution which led these characters to be who they were. Where did their hate, their anger, their racism, where did it come from? And it was all believable. That was the beauty for me, watching that unfold. And Woody, what's his name?
Harrelson
is one of my favorite actors, who I think is underrated. But anyway, his story was so important because he was actually a trigger for everyone else evolve.
Right. And although it was about these three billboards, it was really about his three letters.
Yes. Absolutely.
And the scene by the river with the fishing pole and the little girls, I thought was brilliant.
And I love not knowing. I mean, I got a little angry, but not knowing made you make up your own.
Yeah.
Like, what could have happened? And it could have gone a million ways.
Yeah, that's right. I love the ending.
Yeah.
I saw them. So one of my favorite movies of all time is Fargo.
Mine
too.
And what makes it is,
but I didn't like Fargo.
Is her just her deadpan?
Yes, understatement.
She delivers it, you know, in her own way.
Right.
She's not particularly a beautiful woman,
right?
Yeah.
And so she has to be really good at what she is, and she is. And so she came through again with the same. She always plays strong women, even if they're, you know, underhandedly strong or just, you know. And so I like that about it. I didn't really know. I just knew it was about three billboards. I didn't know billboards. I didn't know anything else.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I only knew what I had heard, the hype of, you know. Mm-hmm. And I knew it was Frances McDormand. And I didn't know anybody else who was in it. But I liked, too, the character study and the fact that, you know, the fact that he came up with the cancer diagnosis.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea that could have, you know, but I thought it was very interesting when she said, what difference does it make?
Yes.
Like her thing is like, yeah, so, you know.
We're all dying anyway.
Yeah, we're all dying anyway. It's more effective before you die.
No, I was going to just reiterate what Stephanie said about it not being tied up at the end in terms of the murder mystery part, because I also, when that file, you know, flew across the stream.
Mm-hmm.
We never saw it again.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't see if Frances McDormand picked it up. We don't know if, and I thought that they would have a scene that they would dig through it and
discover something
new, but
I thought the guy picked it up.
Yeah,
because he was in the fire.
Yeah,
right. He brought it out.
The police coming. They don't show her.
Right.
So I was waiting for her to pick it up.
And she has a backpack.
Yeah,
right.
You know, and they zoom in on the backpack a couple of times. So I thought, oh, they're gonna, and they never do. So
right.
I think that life was completed. You know, that we're all dying every single day. And that was the 16-year-old life. That's done. Now what do we do with what's left behind? Mm-hmm. And that's what, to me, the movie was about. And how do you develop? And I mean, Sam Rockwell was unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was
yeah.
But
yeah.
I started with my daughter, and I didn't catch this until my daughter told me, which is that, I'm just curious as to who caught this, which is the other guy who raped the person.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you realize he did it while he was
in somebody's house?
Well, that's how they do, right?
Yeah,
exactly.
That's what they do.
Wait a minute, say that again.
The other guy who raped someone.
Right, the one
under,
who was talking behind the
yeah,
bar.
Yeah,
right.
Under similar circumstances, because he said, oh, I'm fire, right? And
right,
his
daughter's
daughter was apparently burned as well. So he thought that was a rape because he was behind. But apparently it occurred while he was a circus in the bar.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Presenting.
Yeah.
And yet you don't hear about any of that. And so I think a lot of it is, you know, these parallels. Like, you know, he got a pass.
No, because they were going after him.
Right.
Yeah, maybe.
Well,
no, right. from the authorities, because his superior said it's classified.
Well, that
no,
was another. That was another movie that we saw about what happens with guys in wartime or
right.
during that, and what they do with the women and that whole thing. That's all.
But it was powerful in that scene how they tied Woody's letter to this guy about how, I know you really want to be a detective.
Right.
And then he had this moment of like, I can get the DNA.
Right.
And he created this incident.
Situation.
Right.
Right.
Right. To then, you know, be able to get his DNA and have it tested.
What I found interesting about the movie is that it is very slow. I agree with Gay. But it's so dense. There's so much to it
that's
in
right.
a very slow, not terribly long even, movie. And it goes here and there and here. And, you know, you could pick up about 9 or 10 different threads in the movie,
mm-hmm.
you know, connected to the characters. I thought that was pretty amazing.
You know what I thought was interesting about the scene you just brought up, David, is that I almost felt that... until, and you know, you talk about the power and the influence of another person on one's life
mm-hmm.
or the letter.
Mm-hmm.
I almost feel like he didn't actually know he wanted to be a detective until he read that letter.
I agree.
So the sheriff might have said, I know you want to do this, and maybe he did or not. We, I, I didn't get any indication from his character in the film that he was anything more than taking up space and really was going from one day to the next without actually a destination until that letter and right. somebody says, I believe in you. Yeah. And this is not who you can be.
Right.
You can make a difference.
Each one of those letters had that redemptive quality. Yes. Yes. It's really interesting where he saw something in each person or situation that wasn't obvious or apparent to him.
And he literally just became a different person in the moment he read that letter. It was like magic powder, right? Because then he got locked into the fire. And that was just, you know, then you have the fire, which I think was very metaphorical of that, you know, that that sort of.
Coming through the fire.
Yeah, that cleansing. Because he literally kind of. And he picked up the file. And in that moment, he said. That's right. It was like, this is how I change, how I pivot, right? And then comes through the cleansing fire, and he literally just became another person.
For that affirmation, again, Woody Harrelson's character, the sheriff, had always been a father figure to him. Mm-hmm. But for his affirming his possibility, the possibility that he could be something and do something, make a contribution, that he found his truth in himself. That was among the things I appreciated about it as well.
And you know what was interesting also? I don't watch awards because I'm just not into watching awards. I just don't. You never win, you know the story. But I watched it this time because I want, not the whole thing, but I wanted to see if some of these predictions were true. And he won the first award, the very first award, the best supporting male actor, and he won right away. And I was like, wow, this is good.
Everything
I thought about the movie, you know, just because someone else thought it was great and the critics thought it was great didn't mean that I thought it was great.
Right.
So I agreed. And then when he won that first award, I was like, yeah, he was great.
Something else that I appreciated about it was the writing. Because there are all of these flawed human beings.
Right.
All of these ordinary, simple human beings.
Right.
And it is character-driven.
Mm-hmm.
A character-driven story. But in the writing, what was it? Somebody used the word unfold. The story kept unfolding
and unfolding.
That's right. So that, and the characters' evolutions kept unfolding.
Evolving.
Mm-hmm. And so the reason I was torn, I think, is because, not because I needed a nice, neat, bow-tied ending, but even as somebody put it so nicely, as they were exploring their limits of compassion and of... Some rather vile impulses as well, you know, violent impulses, which was refreshing, frankly, to see, you know, because they're anti-heroes in a whole different way than I remember having been pictured. I like to like the people. Mm-hmm. I found them compelling from the beginning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I wanted to know what was going to happen to these people from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't like them.
There was no political correctness about any of these.
None of that.
I think the writer was really making a statement about small town America.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the isolation and the narrow-mindedness. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And how much it was not keeping up with the times.
Yes.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, what I found really interesting, though, is when the black sheriff showed up. It was like a reminder, like, oh, times have changed.
And we better
get with the program.
But they haven't changed. I went to the theater on 66 in Broadway, and I was the only black person in the theater. And when I got there early, there's a lot of news going on. So I sat in on 50 Shades of whatever, and there was just to pass the time, right? And then
That's all right, Margie.
including me. Three in that movie theater, okay. Right? So when I finally go,
not
and
a
I
billboard.
See, no, the other 56, whatever. So then when I go to see Billboard, it was like, you know, 80% of the theater was filled. And I was like, okay, cool. But I really believe I was the only black person that was in there. So when that scene happened, when the sheriff said to the guy, the young guy, and you
call me Mr. Tips.
Cackling. But before he said that, you know, because remember the young guy said to him, like, something like, fucking you, something like that.
Right.
What the hell are you looking at?
Right, right.
And he was like laughing and giggling. The audience, the people around me, I was like, oh, shit. I'm the only black person in here. But you get it like a true reaction from the audience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not so small town.
What was their reaction?
Their reaction was like they were in agreement with him.
With the white guy.
With the white guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, like how dare he?
It wasn't like, you know, some small town. I'm in New York City
right.
on 66 and Broadway.
On the Upper West Side.
You know what I mean? And they were kind of like, their reaction was like, they understood where he was coming from.
Mm.
That was their reaction. And so as a movie,
I know you saw the star on his, you know,
right.
On his
right.
Oh. Exactly. And then I sat up.
I found interesting though, those small town, yes, but those people knew those that cop for who he was, because they were
right.
like, why you keep messing with black people?
Mm. Right.
Why are you bothering the people of color?
Right.
Why, you know, why are you doing that?
Yeah.
Why did you put this woman in jail?
But that's what they said.
For no reason.
Right.
No, they didn't, but still, the town people had sympathy for that, which you don't usually
find. I don't think, you know what? I think they had sympathy for him.
I agree.
Then why you keep messing yourself up this way? Why you keep putting yourself out there? Because you know one day you will get knocked.
Right.
Yeah. That's how I read it.
That's what the sheriff's letter was saying.
Right.
You know, get it together, man. You'll be good. You're bigger than this. Why do you keep doing that?
I love Woody. What was the purpose of
the house?
The girl who he put in jail, wasn't her in a ball when he was getting beat up?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
What was that? I was just trying to
she
see
was
the purpose
friend.
Of her being there.
She was a friend.
His mother
planted the seed to go after someone that Frances McDormand character.
Right.
So she found. So she went after.
No. I'm talking about the purpose of her being in the
bar.
With
the other guy.
He was getting
beat up.
Even though she knew he was the reason she ended up in jail,
right.
She still had sympathy for him getting beat up.
Right.
And so it showed this like different range of humanity because, you know, even though she had been a victim of injustice, she still could have compassion for someone else.
Right.
Something that he lacked.
Just like the guy who he threw out the window.
Yes.
He found out who he was and he still was like, you know what?
It almost killed the kid. The kid that did it, he did the right thing, and then he burst into tears.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He didn't really want to.
Yeah.
Right.
There's only one thing that bothered me.
Puma wanted to say something.
Oh,
go ahead. So, I did not see the film. Listen to everyone talk about it. It sounds like they made it. Real. Real people.
You would have enjoyed it.
You will enjoy it when you see it.
Yes.
Yeah,
and that was the strength of the film.
Yes.
I
have all the films in case you want to borrow.
You don't say that on camera, woman.
Maybe the Sam Rockwell character was everybody saw him being abused growing up. You know, you had those in the neighborhood. There was that kid. So you do give him a pass because his he was stupid. Was
he doesn't really get a pass, but you
right.
Why
he hated him.
Right.
His mother.
He also was an Easter. Just like you understand Frances, her, I mean, I had to do with her history of abuse, the way she had guilt. The way she went.
Oh, the guilt.
That was interesting. Yeah. That family dynamic.
Yeah.
Bitch.
Right?
Yeah. So you call yourself a bitch.
Somebody's ready to be up
to
each
other.
She was laughing, right? That's not a reaction you get from somebody who's been in jail, but they laughed because, like, they all knew that this cop was so stupid that he wrote up the summons file. But it wasn't even like she was. It was like everybody knew that he does this stuff.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't.
How long was he in the
academy? 5 years.
Janice,
I just wanted to say I agree with everything everyone is saying, especially Stephanie, because if you look at the movie, the three billboards were the MacGuffin. If you know Alfred Hitchcock, he always threw in something that made you think that you were following a particular mystery or clue, but it wasn't about that. It was all about, like David said, the character that in Stephanie, character development and who these characters are and what they do, and you were supposed to try to predict who they were based on what you saw earlier, but they flipped on you. But the one thing that the reason I gave it an A minus was because I really didn't believe that Sam Rockwell's character, I can't think of his name right off the
Jason
bat.
Something.
Whatever.
Jason whatever.
I couldn't quite believe that his character and Frances McDormand character would actually team up, especially since I knew he knew that she was the one who threw the fireball.
And
I figured he would figure that out.
Like,
so I'm
unlikely.
Why duo. Would they? Why?
But
would
she's
they,
here much for blacks too, right?
But I'm my.
So that boy showed up at her door with
I didn't quite believe that they would team up and go after this guy, mainly because why would it was like maybe two days after the firebomb and they're now.
There was more time.
I'm just saying for me, I didn't quite believe that.
I was reminded of when Judy Dench got supporting actress in a role in a film when she was only on at the most 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I thought his mother's role was brilliant. She was just so vile and so horrible and just so believable that I would have nominated her.
What I'm hearing is you're saying somebody can't change. And so we got kids incarcerated and they come out of jail and they get their life together. I got one guy in church. He's now part of the organization that's closing down Rikers, and he was there 9 years in prison. Okay, and now I'll bring Stanley in and you can meet him. And then the other thing, we can change, and we need to be a catalyst, and that's what I saw. We can touch people's lives. How many lives have every one of us touched and brought change about in their lives? And that's what I saw was change. Okay, and even laughing in the theater. Those people, to me, they were laughing at, hey, you know, asshole, you got caught, you know, and so that I didn't think they were laughing at the black police officer.
Yeah.
I felt it was the other way around. They were laughing at him. Yeah. See that, bro? That's your new boss. Mm-hmm. And I felt the audience would have perceived that. Mm-hmm. But again, I just want to let you know people can change. Mm-hmm. You know?
I'm not talking about change. I'm talking about him forgiving her for doing what he did.
How many people have forgiven people for murdering their child?
In the short period of time that it happened.
She's entitled to her suspension of disbelief.
Yeah. Okay, no, I understand that.
I'm just saying it was too quick.
I don't think it was too quick, but I think it still connects back to Woody's letters.
On all of them.
Really triggered a whole self-reflection, mm-hmm. you know, on him in terms of who could I really be and what would I have to do to really become that mm-hmm. person mm-hmm. in all kinds of contexts. And then he saw someone who could have taken ultimate revenge on him in the hospital room mm-hmm. and was able to just let it go.
That domino effect.
Yeah, he triggered a trajectory of self-redemption for that man.
Absolutely.
I want to change my grade back to A.
Say that after all of this, I changed my vote.
You see the power of persuasion?
Yeah.
And Darlene, you have anything to say?
I mean, I really liked it.
And I didn't hear from you badly either.
Okay. I gave it a B+. So, you know, it's a great thing.
That's high praise.
Yes, yes.
I thought it was one of the more original screenplays that been produced in a really long time. To take a murder, a rape murder, mm-hmm. and make it into a comedy.
A dark comedy.
Yeah. It was very dark. I mean, my only criticism of the film, I thought the performances were really good. It dragged a bit. Mm-hmm. At parts, and I felt a little guilty finding humor in some of these situations given the background of the situation. So,
you didn't feel guilty when the brother showed up, right?
No, I was
but just the underlying story that it was a hard pill to swallow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To kind of chuckle, you're like, you almost feel, you know.
But I think one of the things, sorry.
So is your B+ because of your guilt?
I agree with the point about the originality of the screenplay because what we all thought, what I know a little bit about the movie beforehand, and what those of us who did thought was going to be kind of, and typically is in these movies, the central thing mm-hmm. about the movie, right? Mm-hmm. The thing that brings your sympathy forward, the thing that has you sympathizing and empathizing with characters, the thing that moves the story forward. It actually became such a minor
part.
It kept things rolling, but it was a minor thing. I'm surprised they even gave the daughter a memory, mm-hmm. like they brought her to life, because I almost think that the movie would have been just fine almost exactly if they hadn't done that, mm-hmm. Because then it was just a detail mm-hmm. that everything else kind of revolved around. And I like the fact that they didn't solve the case, because there are so many unsolved cases. Yeah. It just brought
things
forward.
Don't get wrapped up that time. One second, I want to hear from Valerie because I haven't heard from her yet.
Yeah, so I had gave it a B+ as well, and the reason I gave it that is because I am a mother of two girls. So immediately I was like, I should not be laughing at anything in this movie because I'm a mother of two girls. I sort of started to self-reflect, like, what the hell is wrong with my humor? Mm-hmm. And then I thought, there's some unlikely duels, and I, for whatever reason, I'm one of those people that I hate not having closure. Like, the movie from 2000, Cast Away with Tom Hanks, I needed to know what was in that envelope. I needed to know when they were driving, like, a male and female version of Thelma and Louise. Like, are y'all gonna do this, or are you not? You know what I mean? So it sort of left me kind of hanging in the balance. And then it dragged on a bit because I fell asleep and I woke up and I'm like, this movie's still going on. Like, what's so that's why I gave it a bit. But I do like the sort of like, there could be more to this story. Is there going to be a number two? It's really heavy. I don't think y'all need to do that. But I didn't, you know, as a mother of two female children, that is my worst fear.
Yeah.
Can I ask you a question? Because it was also it was nominated for Best Original Screenplay.
Yeah.
Did you think it was better than Get Out?
I honestly, we had a pool at work for the Oscar winners, and I actually picked this movie to win.
For Original Screenplay?
I was thrilled Jordan Peele won, but if, you know, my personal bias aside, I probably would have picked this film over that one, even though I love Get Out. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, going to what David said, you know, I think it was a stroke of genius about the letter, because I think that's what really counts. And now him hearing everybody talk, I'm saying, suppose he had not written that letter.
Well, then
what kind of, I mean, the movie would not have, it wouldn't have been that good.
It would have been totally different.
You know, because the letter connected everybody.
Yeah.
And then also, when I was watching this, I'm a Frances McDormand fan.
All
right. I saw her in Blood Simple.
Yes.
It feels so
well, she's married to one of the Coen brothers.
And Fargo. And this movie reminded me so much of Fargo and Blood Simple because it all takes place in those small towns, right? But it was really character driven.
Mm-hmm.
All the characters in both those movies were heavy characters.
Yeah.
You know, I gave her an A+.
Yeah.
Frances.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I gave her an A+.
All the time.
She deserves it.
I wanted to say about the reason why they put that one little scene about the daughter in there. Because the important part of that scene was when she said, "I hope I get raped." And her mother says, "I hope you get raped as well." And I think that was what's driving her with the three billboards. So I think that was the only reason they put that scene.
And that's the last thing she said.
It showed the relationship in the home.
Fact that the mother said, "I hope you get raped too," is to me that's why she
you're right.
She's not letting it go.
Right. That's part of it.
Was not believable to me.
What? Which was?
They have water.
Put the cameras on. Woody was old enough to be them kids' great grandpa. And that wife from Australia.
Yes, she's Australian.
Oh, yeah. Why does she have that?
I didn't get that. I didn't get that.
Did
her plane crash?
He might have gone to a sheriff's
convention.
In Australia?
Anywhere.
Send an old man. Anywhere.
What about the husband that was going out with the 19-year-old? I mean, they just paralleled
themselves. I thought that less. Credible about it for me was that he was staying in this small town doing it.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed to me that he would have like gone to the next town.
Who? What?
The
husband. Oh, it don't matter. Because everybody's gonna go anyway. What I was happy about though, thank God we had a Frances McDormand, the woman that she was, to balance off the two nitwits, the 19-year-old and the girl that worked in the office.
Right.
And the daughter.
The daughter was 16. I give her a break, but these were other. When that girl said, "Oh yeah, I was reading." In a book about horses with polio, and then polo.
No, but what about the scene where Woody was interrogating Frances, and then he coughed
the
blood went over,
and then you saw her compassion.
My
favorite part of the movie was when she read his letter and he told her he paid for the
billboards.
That was great.
Harold,
do you want to say
anything
from behind the camera?
Quarter to nine.
No, he just
recorded. Okay. All right. Well, all right. I think that we all enjoyed.
I have seen gods fly. I've seen men build weapons that I couldn't even imagine.
Uh-huh.
I've seen aliens drop from the sky.
Yeah.
But I have never seen anything like this. How much more are you hiding?
Hold up.
Let's go. We are home. My son, it is your time.
Show me my respect and bow down.
You get to decide what kind of king you are going to be. Don't freeze.
I never freeze.
The revolution will not be televised.
Show me my respect. And bow down. We own ya. We own ya. We only getting started now. Cause we own ya. Just gotta think they know me now. Cause we own ya. You and I my homie. Cause we own ya.
I waited my entire life for this. The world's gonna start over. I'ma burn it all.
What happens now determines what happens to the rest of the world.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out.
What's on that
forever? The revolution will not be televised.
Let's have some fun.
The revolution will be live.
Ed's
right there.
All right. Ed, yes, go get started, honey.
Thank
Why'd you,
you
pick it?
Thank
In
you.
Case anybody doesn't know.
Such a struggle for me, you know?
Only black people.
Gosh, if I said I've been waiting for this movie for years, it'd be an understatement. I've been waiting for this movie for years. As a self-professed comic book nerd from the time I was a small child, me and all of my friends growing up, we could always imagine a point where we would reach in movie technology where they could do these comic book, you know, characters and stories justice. And we finally reached that era very recently. So obviously the next
kitchen
next expectation anticipation was seeing our character, our hero, in one of these movies done right. So once they introduced the Black Panther character in one of the other earlier superhero films, I was just ready. I was just ready. I'm like, this is it. This is the time. So I waited with bated breath, and finally it came. So there was gonna be nothing stopping me from picking this movie.
So when did you buy your ticket?
I actually was not planning to see it that opening weekend. However, my best friend, I worked that Saturday. My best friend called me. I was at work, so he left me a voicemail, and I didn't listen to the voicemail. I just called him right back. He's like, "Why are you calling me?" And I said, "What do you mean?" He's like, "Did you see the movie?" I said, "No." I said, "He told me in the voicemail, I told you, don't call me unless you've seen the movie." I've known this man most of my life, and he basically told me, I was anticipating he wouldn't like the film because he wasn't a big fan of the Black Panther character. You know, he was a fan of other comic book characters. And he said, "Ed, I literally shed a tear." And that was enough reason for me to, you know, jump on Fandango and get a ticket despite the snow.
That's right, it snowed.
Nothing is going to stop me from seeing this movie. And I did. And I loved it.
Honestly. And what is your rating?
I give it a big fat 8.
Wow!
That is on
record.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
A big fat 8.
Wow! That's almost 8+.
Well, in his universe, yes, it is an A plus. Nothing.
That's probably pre-alphabet.
Yeah.
Tony.
The next.
Yeah. So now I will admit that the reason I didn't give an A to the previous movie is because I was saving my A.
For Black Panther. All right.
Okay. It's an A plus plus. Whatever.
Oh, plus plus. Okay. Yeah.
That's bigger than
A. Look, let me just say, it's a wonderful thing. Yay.
Let me admit that I saw it the first day that it was the show, yeah. And I had my ticket for a month before that. So I, you know, beyond the fact that I'm not a comic book, you know, aficionado, but I think as a movie, there are a number of things that I would say. First of all, it was
great.
Okay, A plus.
Thank you. Ramona.
No, Denise.
Oh, Denise, I'm sorry. Because you know what? She didn't see the last movie, so I didn't have her in order.
Okay.
Okay, dokie.
A plus.
Okay, wait a minute. Let me just write down Denise.
And the popcorn is in honor of the Black Panther.
you gave it an A plus.
India.
I give it an A.
And
Puma.
Gave it a C.
Z.
Puma?
What?
Ooh. Okay.
Puma?
We're gonna. Not to worry.
Did you see it?
Zanetta?
She saw it.
Z?
that's not a grade.
Is that your grade? Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, we'll jump over.
We'll come back. She wants to tell you.
Go ahead.
And Jean.
A plus plus.
Steph.
A.
June.
A plus plus.
Ramona.
A.
Harold.
Hey.
Oh, Nelly didn't see it. Asato.
What about that?
I'll take that. Marty's next. I don't know. I decided this way it happened.
I'm almost with Puma.
Oh.
Almost with Puma.
Dion.
Give a grade.
Dion.
C plus.
B plus.
I think I got to go B minus.
Okay.
Well, wait a minute. We skipped over you?
No, Marty's coming around. Oh,
I give it an A.
Okay. I'm sorry, Zanetta's not here. I'll go backwards. I don't know how I did this before. No, really, because I'm coming down and I'm like, where's David? And where's... Interesting. Okay, lucky, doesn't matter.
David.
I'm sorry, A minus.
Did you get Ramona?
Yeah, I got my A. A for me.
A. Mona.
What'd she say?
She said A.
And I said I wanted B.
Oh. Yeah, she had me already. Okay.
That's another.
She gave them a B for bathroom.
Black Panther rating.
A minus.
That was funny. Mm-hmm. Did Gwen give Black Panther a rating?
A.
Oh, okay. Just want to make sure. And,
Monique didn't reach out to you, huh?
Oh. No, she didn't send me her grade. She reached out to me.
Oh, Gladys gave it a B.
Oh, Valerie didn't give you her grade.
Well, he didn't finish. I'm getting there. I am getting there. Janice?
A plus plus.
Okay, I'll get Anita's tell you in a minute. Mine was an A, Nero?
A minus.
Carl?
What's up, Steve?
A minus.
Can you come back?
I'm
right
here.
Ron?
I'm with Puma C.
Hilarious.
Just give me a service. She'll come back.
Your B?
B.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Give it a B.
Yeah. Val?
Yeah. I give it a V for Victorious and Vibranium.
Oh. Yeah. Oh.
There you go. Vibranium. Go ahead, Val.
Val.
Is that your answer?
Victorious Val with the Vibranium.
That's obviously good.
I guess that's an A.
It's like a double V.
It's like a big fat A.
Which is a double
upside down A.
Okay.
Right.
So.
You didn't
Right. Because you never have enough. Yeah, I never have enough. I give it an A plus. Daphne. Daphne is an A plus. And Anita, I believe, gave it.
What about Gladys? A B.
B. She gave it a B. A plus plus from Anita. Okay. And in her absence, since she wrote me this whole long text message, I will just read it. I give it a grade. We'll finish giving grades, and we're going to open it up with a
text.
This is Anita.
With a thesis.
It's a thesis. Sorry, missing this discussion. Blah, blah, blah. The films for this month are two favorites now. Anyway, Black Panther. This film, in its handling of us, is now my favorite movie of all time. I give it an A++! Exclamation point. I appreciate Ryan Coogler and all the research he did in Africa. They seemed very authentic. The South African actor who played T'Challa's dad spoke. I can't click.
Osa.
My friend's children call their dad Baba. That's why, okay. An actor was in Wakanda at the gathering with a lip ring in his mouth. There was a reference in the beginning showing they were in Oakland, Coogler's home, and where the Black Panthers were created. I love that the soldiers were formidable. I love the Bond moment when the sister was showing the brother all the new weapons she created. She is his own personal Q. But for Bond people. The Mumba speech. Patrice Lumumba's speech at the UN was incorporated when T'Challa spoke there. He was murdered a year later. Coogler incorporated the Black Panthers' belief system, Kwame Nkrumah's Pan-Africanism. I was so proud. They put one good white boy. They put in one good white, and boy, was I grateful not to have him save the day.
Yes.
There was nothing
was
demeaning. There was nothing
he
demeaning, ingratiating, or emasculating in the entire film. As I said, it's now my favorite film about us. It's above Moulin and Buckin' the Preacher. They had the Moulin. Okay. So, lowest grades.
So the reason why my mom gave it a C, she said, is because, as you all know, she's not into the violence. So she said it was extremely violent for her.
It was awesome. Too contrived.
There we go.
Yeah, well, that's what
it was. It was a comic book.
So about 30 minutes into the movie, she said, how much longer is this movie? I said, about 2 more hours. She was like, I'm about ready. I was like, okay. So,
She went to the reclining theater, the recliner, and then she
came. Where is the recliner?
You know, it's funny because when I watched it, I said that I know that a lot of schools are taking their kids there to see it and everything, but the younger kids might see nothing past the violence.
Right.
Like, they might not see, the real meaning behind all of this. Whereas if they got a little bit older, they'd really appreciate that more. So that was one thing too, because I mean, when I saw it the first time, all I was seeing was all the fighting and everything. But by the second time when I saw it, I really saw what was going on, and I started to really appreciate, where it was coming from and the history behind it all, and how it was, that it was really pride in our community and our heritage and all, which is the part that I hope that the kids are getting. And not just everybody would be running around with swords and trying to,
See, I don't think that's the part they focus in on, to me. I don't think they focus in on the violence. They focus in on the fact that there was a Black nation that...
But you have to be older to see that.
I don't think so.
I think it needs to be pointed out. It has to be pointed out. I mean, kids don't understand the significance of it. Mm-hmm. And that's where guidance comes. That you don't watch it, let a kid watch it supervise that they are. I'm hoping that some of the schools that are taking their kids give them some insight before they go, and then have some discussion afterwards.
Yes. Part of what I like about it as a comic book or as a superhero story it was significantly different from every other superhero story in the sense that he had neither individual powers or gadgets. Mm-hmm. All of his power came from his civilization.
No, he had gadgets.
But they were not like Batman, him being rich and then sort of commissioning someone to make them for him. Mm-hmm. He stepped into a role as a superhero that had already been created by that civilization. Mm-hmm. The power resided within the civilization, not within the individual. And for me, just even separate and apart from, I think, the meaning of that for black people, I just think as a superhero, it's so different from every other superhero story where, you know, you're from Krypton and you have this power, you were bitten by a spider, you have that power, you know, you can see through walls and you can stretch, blah, blah, blah. It's not that there was something innate in him as an individual and that whatever it was that he had would die with him. It was that that civilization had evolved to a point where it could then empower their leader to have power on behalf of the civilization. And that, for me, was the most profound part of it.
I'm sorry. I just want to get Isato because you gave it the next lowest grade, and I want to hear. I want to hear.
And Ron.
Ron
gave it a C, but Isato gave it a B.
That's from the norm. Well, you know, I'm a long time Wakandan.
You don't have to give your.
I'm not having any problem with Africa. Me and Africa are good. I'm cool with Africa. What I do have, what I had a problem with is all the young people that are going to see it. I did go to the reclining show. The theater, where I was one of a few people, you know, from uptown. Mm-hmm. I wasn't the only, you know, person of color there, but I was one of the few that was from uptown. I could hear a pin drop. Mm-hmm. And there was all of a sudden a rumbling, like a large delegation of kids that came in and sat in the front row, and they were late, and they made all this noise, and they were all from West Africa. They were all from West Africa.
Nice. Wow.
And they had on their half of their piece. They didn't have on the whole head. Y'all could tell they were Sinhalese or Guinean or something like that. And they were acting like niggas. I'm sorry. They were like,
how old were they?
Teens. Right? But I realized at the end when I saw them all standing at the poster, you know, with their thing. That this is their movie.
Yeah.
Their moment. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they've endured all the slings and arrows of ignorant African Americans who go to school with them and say that they're jungle bunnies and whatever. And this is their moment.
Right.
And I was proud for them. But what I didn't like was the fact that the protagonist was African American and that he was African American. And that he was the crazy one.
That the villain.
The villain. I didn't like that. And I felt like for people who don't go any further with their research than that movie, this is going to be an issue in our community. This one's gonna be a dirty secret, like the light skin, dark skin thing. Mm. It's gonna be a dirty secret that you all don't know anything and see, we can see that. We know more, and this is what it is, you know. So it didn't have a unifying piece for me, and that I had a problem. Let me just also preface this, and you know, I do apologize for all those comic book people. I've never read a comic book in my life, and I've never, Ta-Nehisi. I did get Ta-Nehisi Black Panther because I saw him in. I got them, but I didn't even read them. So it's not a format that resonates with me. Hmm. So and not one that my kids. So I've never seen an Avenger. I've never seen any Marvel movies ever. So that may be it. So for me, I'm looking at it like a movie. My community, these messages, and what happens. I'd much prefer Get Out. So I'll just
okay.
Ronald, can I just get you a C comment, please, darling?
Too violent. I didn't see, I mean, I saw the historical aspect for me, but I don't think the youth are going to get it at all. Already they're dancing the dances on the internet and so on down the line. I couldn't wait to leave. I have the first half an hour myself. And I'm not into comic books at all. And the comic book, that animation, I was looking for the errors in the animation and what the background was faking. I just couldn't follow the script at all. And I didn't enjoy the movie at all. I gave it a C because of the meaning behind it and as such. But other than that, I would have given it an F.
Baby, too.
Okay.
Tell us how you really feel.
Gay, I know you were trying to say something earlier.
Well, I mean, it's maybe missed the point where it had relevance. But I thought it was just a feel-good movie. I thought that there were beautiful black people on the screen.
Beautiful, yes.
Men and women, and I thought that was, you know, not just one. You know, so that was quite interesting. And I thought that they did try to, include some of the themes that, you know, are in our community, whether they are positive in a sense. I mean, the thing between the sort of sense of the nationalists or, you know, the diaspora split with the continent, I thought was, you know, I think it's real. And I think that, you know, not surprising, it's real. But I thought that the resolution was that a positive one, which was that even though the guy from the diaspora didn't win the fight, you know, there was a resolution, a reconciliation with him, and a decision by
T'Challa
to use the technology of Wakanda to benefit and to deal with the issues in that are present in the diaspora. So I thought that was, you know, a useful resolution which gave a lesson to those from the continent who were really listening for, you know, a lesson.
Can I do a pop poll real quick? How many people by hand thought Killmonger was a hero?
Who?
Killmonger
was a hero?
The African-American character.
Michael B. Jordan.
Was a hero?
I can't say he was a hero.
I can't give a yes or no.
I don't think he's a hero, but I also do not think he's a villain. I think he's misunderstood. I think he was looking for, he was displaced.
No, well,
he was displaced. And I think that it is important when the younger generation communicates with the older generation, and they say, I respect you and I love you, but I think in this particular instance, you made a mistake, and you and your decision has resulted in him making this sort of
One of the things that really struck me that came out of his hurt and being abandoned, and that's why I really liked when he went back, when they buried him, he went back to the ancestors. You can see it's the hurt and the abandonment in our communities. I think he grew to be awful.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, he killed his lover, just cold-blooded. Mm-hmm. You know, and he was awful. However, at the very end, T'Challa was very compassionate with him. Mm-hmm. He stood up there and he talked about his relationship with his father. My father always said the sunset was the most beautiful. And mm-hmm. I choose to be buried in the ocean with the ancestors mm-hmm. who did not right. submit, or that's not mm-hmm. quite
yeah.
it.
Who didn't so survive, yeah. Who didn't survive.
Yeah. But what did they lie? They chose death over slavery,
right. over bondage,
over bondage mm-hmm. which I thought was really an important
yes.
message, and it was almost redemptive.
Before I'd be a slave.
Yeah, it was almost redemptive of his character. But he also embodied so much of just the horrific things that are happening and are perpetuated by us against us.
Yeah.
And even though you understand, there is a consequence for your actions. You know, that doesn't sound like God loves everybody. God doesn't discriminate against, and there's nothing one can do that will separate one from that universal love and power. You still are responsible for your actions
Amen.
And the consequences of it.
So,
Tony.
You know, one thing I will say, I kind of disagreed with him when he chose to go to with his ancestors, because I've always taken pride in the fact that I'm a descendant of people who didn't give up, who didn't kill themselves, who didn't. They chose bondage and life, and I'm here because of that. So I have to say, his ancestor didn't die. His ancestor lived.
Because well, his that's ancestor how he was in Africa.
Well, what half?
What half?
Presumably. So I'm just saying that his ancestor, in fact, was not the one who went
But I don't know if ancestry had to do with his taking himself out. He knew that he'd have to pay for what he had done.
Right.
And that's the bondage.
I'm just saying, I didn't agree with that statement.
And his ancestral connection was not nearly as strong as T'Challa's. T'Challa had ancestral,
absolutely.
Which can speak. Now, I also had a little issue with T'Challa. You can't go to the ancestral realm and be talking bad to the ancestors. I don't care what you're talking about. You know, I don't believe in that. I didn't believe in that. That
you didn't believe the challenge
when he was talking to his father, although he had a point, but I don't know.
He said the woman who called her African children acting like niggas.
Yeah.
Well, but I think that in that moment there was no subtle way of him being able to say,
right.
I disagree with the choice you
made.
The screenplay could have done better with us.
No, but that's real, though.
But I'm not sure that in a superhero movie,
after your father has passed away, if you find out that this perfect, because some people do see their fathers or their mothers mm-hmm. as being perfect. Mm-hmm. Maybe not everybody, mm-hmm. but some people do see that. And if that's what it is, and then you find out afterwards that your father had a baby outside of the marriage, I'm sorry, it's real to have that discussion.
Absolutely.
You know, even in death, you're not going to have that reference.
Now, here we are, educated people, making these discussions.
Side conversation.
But what I'm saying is, and you really think these young kids that are in grammar school, middle school, high school, going
to
pick up on
this?
Absolutely not. And yes, and is it being discussed in the school?
Well, it is.
Or
maybe
we need to go discuss it in the schools.
On some levels, I think it is.
They have
I think the value of this, we are sitting around here right now, 18, 20, however many of us are here, and having this discussion about this film, I'm going to ask Ron this one question,
you know, especially because this was the beginning of the movie.
And then we'll go to these.
This was the beginning of the movie. The Black Panther went with his team to rescue African women.
Right.
And you don't think that resonated in these children's minds?
No, not at all. Not at all.
Not that they had to know the story that's actually taking place on the continent, but it was clear something bad was happening to these girls, and the Black Panther said, we have to go do something about it.
Right.
And did. And was a hero, was a superhero.
Now I'm going to bring it up in class next week.
Went with who did he take with him? But who did he take with him to do that? Who did he take with him?
Female warriors.
Thank you.
Female warriors.
You don't think that resonated for our children?
Yes.
Wait, 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 wait.
He didn't take her with him.
Denise.
Not all of them. One of them went by herself.
Right. Denise.
Kids have no idea who Martin Luther King is.
Denise, come on now.
I have to applaud this.
Yo. One by one voice.
Denise,
I have to applaud this film for a particular amount of honesty that doesn't attempt to resolve these dichotomies one way or another and just presents them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the thing is that presenting the situation that child is in that he has high-minded ideals for black folk, but at the same time, he treats other black folk like dirt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's one of those things. It just is.
Right.
And it comes up, and it is. And it shows you, you know, all of the factors that came into him being the way he is, but it is. And the same thing when it comes to, you know, to the discussion that the new king has with his father. I mean, you have a difference of opinion, you know, all of us, the person you who I thought you were is not there. I have to have a conversation with you about this, you know, whether you like the way he talked to his, you know,
right.
I mean, the thing
right.
Is it was
right.
Honest.
I agree.
You know, this is what I'm feeling.
I agree.
The other thing is that whether the youth understand the way this is or not, the thing is, and it's one of the things that I think came up early out of Disney from, probably began with, what is that movie, Splash, the mermaid one?
Little Mermaid?
Splash. Little Mermaid?
No.
Oh, you mean an animated. You mean Splash.
I think it's Splash, the one where
Tom Hanks and
Belle.
Which is that
you know, you're looking at what could be a kid's movie, but at the same time doesn't just speak to kids.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with this movie.
Yeah.
Whether the kids get it or not, there are other people who do.
Yeah.
You know? And there's no reason to kill a movie because the kids don't get it.
True.
You know? There are other people who do get it. Mm-hmm. And I like the fact that, you know, that it speaks to you wherever you are, whether you get all of it or you just get some of it, or you know, whether you get this much or this much.
Hear, hear.
You know? Mm-hmm. And so.
But the problem. One second. I'm sorry. Stephanie Dunmartin. Will you finish? And then. I'm sorry. Will you finish? I'm sorry.
And Harold wants us.
No, I don't want to try to get his attention.
Ed?
Me?
No. Thank you.
Okay. And I know, Valerie, you had your hand up.
I just want to say that initially, the initial impact, and actually this experience possessed me throughout, that I kept thinking as a young girl, really being quite ashamed of my features and my nose and my hair, and never seeing myself projected as pretty.
Mm-hmm.
It took me a very, very long time to imagine myself as being pretty. And I was just enthralled and overwhelmed by the beauty of that man would know. I wear my hair like in those little knots, and I've worn my hair anyway, and the lock anyway. So that was the first thing that we were all so beautiful, really portrayed in all different shades. And what I love the political dichotomies and the political issues that were hinted at that we've been struggling with for years. Not only in America, but the diaspora.
Mm-hmm.
What bothered me and why I didn't give it an A++, because I love the violence and the adventure. Even I see it in my face. But, you know, and riding through that, I love all that. But what bothered me, and it might not be fair, it might be personal, I have never believed since childhood that anybody in this world respects an American nigger. and I say nigga purposefully.
I didn't get this.
You
point.
Can come from anywhere else and be dark, and if you have an accent or anything that distinguishes you from being born and raised here, no matter what you do, you will be more respected than the best of us here.
No,
and that's what bothered me about Michael's character. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of personal, mm-hmm. that subconscious perception of us as American Black people was perpetuated, perhaps not deliberately, but in my mind that was perpetuated. And all of Michael Jordan, no, he wasn't a hero, but there was some things
he
without struggle, there is no progress. I'm not saying that he should have bought the weapons from Africa and given them out in the community to destroy the white power structure or whatever. I'm not saying that. But without struggle, there is no progress. So to totally dismiss the concept of urban revolution bothered me too. And that everything was so neatly put together by the Africans and not us.
See, I didn't get. I thought that there was more room in there for appreciation of the situation here in the U.S. You know, the question of urban struggle. I didn't think it was totally mixed. Maybe I missed that point.
I think it was. Let me just say something else to it about that. So the other thing from
So
it would have been a different film, and it wouldn't have been about the Black Panther.
Mm-hmm.
Have they done more about the American?
I'm not a comic book
stuff like that. No.
All right.
I came to comic books a little late, between ages. I didn't start reading comics until I was 13, 14. I collected, in that 2-year period, I collected maybe a couple of hundred comic books. And I didn't get with the Black Panther. But I remember starting in 1978, which I think was the first Superman film, Stanley Donen. Steve, what was his name? Christopher Reeves. Right. I, whenever one of those big, whether it's DC or Marvel franchise comics strip films has come out, I have frequently, until the glut of the last few years, been turned into an overgrown 13-year-old again. So. For me, this film, I was kind of like Ed. It's kind of, for me, actually, Moonlight was the movie I've always been waiting my whole life for. Mm. But this was close in terms of my overgrown 13-year-old. And so I was thrilled. I was thrilled about the exquisite blackness that filled the screen.
Yes.
From one end to the other.
Yes.
I was thrilled about my perception that, kind of like yours, what made this superhero T'Challa different than any that I've seen before was that he, while grounded in his heritage, said, "My father was wrong. My father was wrong, and I'm not going to do what my father did. I'm going to lead differently." I thought that was brilliant. I thought that the questions that Kubler raised about notions of the notion that tribalism might have been the original sin by which we were enslaved, that we were divided and conquered in the first place, was brilliant. I didn't know that Ryan Coogler had directed it. So when sitting there and his name flashed across the credits at the end, I burst into tears. I burst into tears of joy because I thought this story, picturing exquisitely beautiful African women as warriors, the equal of the men. Yes. I thought, whoa, what is this? What is happening here? What is happening here? And a super brilliant genius scientist, you know, leader, princess, warrior princess. What world is it? And all of it because it was picturing an African civilization that had not been colonized. That possibility, that potential is like, my Lord, what a morning. Mm-hmm. And so I was just thrilled from the beginning to the end.
Janice. So I think for me, the reason why I gave it an A++ was all of that, the beauty of the movie, the portrayal of the women as beautiful yet strong, and as what's his name? Said in a lot of the interviews, I can't think of his name right.
Chadwick Boseman.
Thank you. He was saying in all the interviews, and so did Ryan Coogler, who actually wrote the movie as well.
Yes.
He was saying that, you know, they pulled from all of the Black Panther comic books, but the portrayal of the women, because they had evolved and they were not colonized, the men were not threatened by the women, and so the women were able to be their full potential. So they could do whatever. If you were a warrior and you wanted to be a warrior, you could be a warrior. The men weren't threatened by that. And it was just that whole portrayal of the what could have been if Africa had not been colonized was just so beautifully imagined, and I love that. But the profound moment in the movie, and why I couldn't answer, David, your question, is whether or not Michael B. Jordan's character was a hero, because sitting in the movie theater, you could hear a pin drop, but that point in the movie where he confronted T'Challa and said, I think it was, I don't remember the conversation, but it was all about how Africa could have saved the United States had they used, you know, their technology and their weapons. Mm-hmm. And I think the whole issue with his portrayal in the movie was about his father had been teaching him who he was. Mm-hmm. So he knew he was a Wakandian. Mm-hmm. And also learning about his heritage. And the rage of knowing that his people killed his father, because remember when he was a little boy, he looked up and saw them leaving. Right. So his people killing his father, he was abandoned, left in the U.S., and then he had to deal with this struggle by himself. Right. So I think that was all of that anger against Wakanda, because he knew who he was. They didn't technically save him.
They didn't accept him.
His whole life was about getting this revenge against them for really essentially abandoning him and our people in the U.S. Mm-hmm. So to me, that was the really profound moment in that film for me. And I sat there and I was like, because that's why I couldn't say he was a villain. Right. I don't think he was a villain.
He was a person.
Boseman kept saying in interviews, and I agree, was that they were the flip side of the same coin. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
he confronts Africa and says, look at us, children that you have abandoned. Right. You don't even recognize us as being your children.
I think that you actually, two things that didn't come up but have been said. It is really about self-reflection. Mm-hmm. When you question your elders and you say, hey, elder, I respect you and I have the utmost of respect for you and I want to take our traditions forward, but I think we need to tweak this.
Right.
The second thing is, cliche as it may be, hurt people.
Yes,
and that is what the mother was.
That's right.
That person,
exactly.
So if we're looking at it from a let's be self-reflective, and also oftentimes we do things, and as a Black community, we don't want to say, hey, I know that we're all Black and we look the same, but this is not right, and this is what you should do. We kind of don't want to say that. We want to whisper behind it, but if we're going to be great as a people, we got to check each other, right, and we have to be okay with that. If
and
I'm doing something,
can
wrong,
I just
need
say,
my say,
I say we can check each other,
exactly.
But I don't like standing in front of the elders and pointing your finger at them and telling them, you know, I think there's a way that you can say this hasn't gone the way that it should have gone, and we can do better.
That's different than coming back. Because you have to understand, we're talking to people who don't know the difference. For all they know, we can die, go talk to the elders, talk bad to them, and come back. I mean, you know, that's...
He didn't talk bad to them.
He was kind of rough with that. He was kind of rough with his father. You were wrong. You were wrong.
He
was wrong. But there was a way to do it. And I just don't think that's the way to do it.
Oh, I didn't have an issue with it.
I didn't have an issue.
Who called the African children niggas?
Hold on a second. No, John Martin, I'm going to let you go. So anyway, but the other thing is this, and that's why I wanted to speak to the brother here who's the teacher. The problem is when you are a teacher before a group of children, the knowledge base is limited to yours.
Right.
It's limited to your knowledge base.
That's right.
It's limited to how much you know, how much you believe, and how much, if that's what you're going to give to those 35 or 40 kids in your...
And how much you can perceive.
You can't give what you don't have.
You can't give what you don't have. So we're leaving Marvel and Disney... the responsibility of educating some teachers to then educate some children based on some something that's a little, some of it's good. I'm not going to say it's all bad, but all of it wasn't good.
Madam Hope, if I could just say this.
Yes.
You know.
I want to just say one other thing. My children are half African. Okay. Go.
Look, I mean, this is a movie. Number one. Mm-hmm. And as a movie, I think it's a pleasant, great, you know, that's beautiful, great. Has a lot to say. I also think that on a substantive level, what you see out of this conversation is that this movie raised a lot of questions that are and put on the table, you know, the basis for a good conversation on all this with kids. Now, you know, yes, we have to rely, or we do rely often, on teachers having to know it and have it all. But that's actually not the way it should be going.
But it is.
Okay, but that does not mean...
It's not right.
Yeah, but that's another point. My point is simply that this gives teachers an extra something, which is that it puts out there on the table a lot of issues that could be discussed back and forth in a way that really sort of raises their
Let's remember who the majority of the teachers that our kids have.
Okay, but that's a different point. You know, I mean, for the ones who do want to do something, here's a movie.
Right.
We can't talk about all the rest of them, but, you know.
First of all, I tell all my students, you challenge me and you challenge your teachers. And I tell them, you go home, because most of you probably have parents that have not been formally educated or have limited education, and you go home and teach them. And you But I tell them to go to each class and do that.
But that's
because
you.
I have to inspire them.
That's you.
Yeah, and that's I understand
you.
That.
You know, the majority of the teachers teaching our kids are not doing that and don't have the capacity to do that.
So what does that have to do with
the film? So, you know, one of the things I think we forget is that culture and entertainment has its longest term impact on the archetypal level.
Yes.
Okay? And so I think we forget that, you know, what was most important about this is that, you know, going back to, as you were saying, 1978 with Christopher Reeve playing, you know, Superman, our kids have not had the opportunity to see us
as superheroes
in those roles.
Thank you, Papa.
And I think the long-term impact, because Black Panther's here to stay.
Hello.
Whether you like him or not.
Hello.
And it's important for our kids to now see themselves in that space.
In a positive space.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
In a heroic space.
To see their potential. Not that you have superpowers, but that you can be heroic, that you can make heroic choices and impact. And I think that really was the long-term impact. And I don't think that it's insignificant that they see black women as warriors and, yes. and as heroes. I don't think it's insignificant that they saw the Black Panther's first action in the movie as going to rescue
black
those
women.
Sisters.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Current
situation.
You know, the thing that's interesting, and we've touched on some of the gender dynamics. The gender dynamics were probably the most revolutionary part.
Come on, come on. Please, and please permit me, Papa.
Please.
David asked a question before we started rolling tape again that I think was vitally important. And correct me if I'm paraphrasing you incorrectly. You asked if we thought Black Panther will be as powerful a moment
or
have more impact than the Million Man March did.
Yes.
And
yes.
I will tell you why I think it will. For, and you just answered it yourself. Because it's a cultural touchstone. The impact that films have, particularly where they become iconic films, is on the archetypal level. And I think also in dollars and cents terms. Because
$1 billion
in the first 3 weeks of the run, that's the language that the Zions of the film industry and every industry understand. That's the language they understand. And so now, don't look now. There will be not just Black Panther, they're going to be scared.
There's going to be Black Lion.
Black Tiger. Black Hippopotamus. Okay. Black Elephant. Black Spiders. Nazi.
That's
okay.
I just want to say that, I think that the value that we place on this film shows just how much we needed this film.
Absolutely.
That, I mean, we put a lot of weight and baggage on a movie.
It's a movie.
And it's not even a movie that purports to be based in reality. It purports to be based in fantasy. So, I think
That shapes our minds.
Yes, but what I'm saying is just the fact that we have found this movie to have such import and be so, to become iconic is telling in and of itself. And yes, I do worry that young kids see it and but I think, and whether or not they just see the violence in it or. But what they will also remember, all of the things that people have said here, that they've seen themselves, something that they've seen themselves reflected in a way. And I've heard kids talk about it, on TV and stuff. They've interviewed some young kids who've seen the movie, and they talk about seeing themselves reflected on that screen. So whether they understand all of the intricacies, all of the political stuff in there, they're taking something from it that they carry in with them. And we should only be so hopeful that, yes, we will have Black Panther 2 and Black Panther 3 and Black Tiger and Black Lion and Black Giraffe
and maybe
Black whatever.
But before that, we're going to say Infinity Wars.
Yes.
Yes, we will.
Exactly.
Yes, we will.
Can I ask this of the group then to put together a series of questions and I will take it into the classroom? All right, and these are college kids.
Right.
Okay.
College kids.
And not, yeah.
Okay.
And not only that, some of the other professors, I will present it to them as well and ask them so we can put together.
So I have one question for you up front.
Okay.
Can they see the connection between this film and The Spook Who Sat by the Door?
Put it on.
So they can do some research. They're college students.
Exactly, and that's the challenge. Because I'm driving here. I remember Shaft and all the other,
Black
flicks.
I kept thinking about Brother from Another Planet.
Because the thing that hit me about Killmonger is that he clearly made a conscious decision to infiltrate the U.S. military-industrial complex,
right,
so that he could get the capacity to not just get revenge on Wakanda, but on all the people he felt had oppressed right. black people around the world. Mm-hmm. And that was a very spooky sat by the door storyline. Mm-hmm.
The book written by
Sam Greeley, and then the film had Billy Dee Williams and who
was
else?
Billy? No.
Billy Dee Williams.
What'd you call it? Spook Who Sat
By the Door? The movie, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the brother who's in Scandal.
Yeah.
That was
Joe, you're talking about Brother from Another Planet.
Spook Who Sat By the Door was not Billy Dee Williams.
Not
Billy Dee Williams. No, he was,
just look how strong our black dollars are.
I don't have my phone with me.
Keep putting it in the right place.
That's my
hard drive. We can stop so many businesses with the currency and everything. Put our black dollars together. Boycott and everything.
But
that wasn't.
But they don't stay in the community. Whereas the white dollar stays in the community.
This wasn't just all our black dollars.
Yes.
We didn't get to $1 billion by just black
people. No, but ours helped a lot.
No, only black people went to see it.
I'm sorry. I was on 84th Street.